This is Rosa Ponselle, talking, and it's a long story, but I'll try to make it as brief as possible. How I came to make records for the Columbia. Well, it seems that at the time of my debut, both Columbia and another very prominent record company were interested in signing me up, and my then manager decided that if I went with the Columbia, I would be the queen, since RCA had all the big names, all the great, great stars of that era, and they didn't have quite as many at the time of the in the operatic field as they have today or since. And so he thought I'd be better off to go with the Columbia, and I'm indeed grateful that I went with the Columbia, for nothing else, but just having met Romano Romani, who was then conductor for the Columbia, and it was through him that I had the pleasure of finally getting to an audition with Caruso. And in fact, Romani, Maestro Romani, prepared me for my audition, and I was immediately promised by Caruso. He was very impressed, and he predicted right there and then I was going to sing with him.
Can you tell us a bit about that debut?
I wouldn't know where to start. And just to think about it, I just shiver all over. It was a miracle. All I can say, it was a miracle. And the Lord was with me, because I didn't think I was going to live through the performance. Well, I didn't know that Caruso also suffered to such an extent at every premiere, which I found out that night, but I didn't even think of him that night, because I was sure I was going to die. I couldn't put my makeup on, and my room was all thickly upholstered carpets, and no one warned me not to vocalize. Don't vocalize in your dressing room, but go out in the corridor where it's all cement floors and nice high ceilings, and you can get a real, true assessment of what voice you're in. But I knew before I left the house there was some voice there, but I said, well, I'm going to die. What difference does it make? I was sure I was going to die. So on the way down, I saw my favorite color in all the windows and everything, any paper, straight papers on the streets and sidewalks, was purple and lavender orchids, which is my favorite color. I said, well, if this is any omen, I'm going to live in spite of it all. So I did the first act, and before Caruso comes on, I've already sung an aria and a duet with my father, big aria, had the stage all to myself before Caruso makes his entrance. But I was so nervous, I said, I am dying, sto morendo. And he would say in between these quick passages, you know that quick passage, you oh my beloved, blah, blah, and I'd have it. And in turn, in between, I said, sto morendo, and she said, coraggio, between these phrases, io ti sostengo. And he was dying in his own tracks. So he, the blind leading the blind, he was trying to give me help because I was his protege, you know, and he felt double responsibility. But he didn't come to wish me well or anything, but I was too nervous to realize that he hadn't come near me because he was having his own traumas in his own dressing room, and the room, they said, filled with smoke because he smoked incessantly. He was a chain smoker, and that's how the nerves reacted with him. But luckily, it never showed in that God-given voice. Well, he came, and I lived through the first act. He went to his dressing room, which was on the other side, not a word to me. I didn't realize he didn't say, only the other, I will be here to sustain you, because he did at that moment feel the responsibility, because it brought back to his mind that Gatti said to him, if this young girl who's only heard two operas in her life and is out of vaudeville is going to come and do Leonora with you, you must have your head examined. He said, well, when you hear her, you'll change your mind. With just no operatic experience, but vaudeville experience is all she's had, and you're going to have her as your Leonora. He said, where do you hear her? You'll change your mind. Well, I'll tell you this. If she makes good, if this American makes good, every door will be open to American potentials from that moment on. And if she doesn't make good, Signor Gatti takes the first ship back to Italy, and America will never see me again. He said, you won't have to take that ship back to Italy, Caruso said. This is before the performance. Well, anyway, God was good to me. I didn't die after the first act, but I said, well, I'll die in the second act, because that's 55 minutes. Just thinking and talking about it now gets me all excited. 55 minutes of all constant singing and a terrific tessitura. And I lived through that second act, and I said, well, the miracle has happened. And then I have an hour and a half just waiting around to sing in the last act, Pace Mio Dio, which I did so easily. When I did La Vergine degli Angeli, I felt I was in heaven, because I lived through the most taxing part, and the tessitura is always on B naturals, way all the gamut. I run the gamut. And never stopping. As you know the opera, and you know how taxing it is. And for a beginner, a baby, in
it's
fact.
A hard way to
oh, play. Yes.
Then when Pace came.
Oh, my. Well, then I could stand in the wings and listen to Caruso and enjoy him and the rest of them because I was relaxed. I wasn't at all worried about the last act that I enjoyed. For some reason, I was greatly relieved and the miracle happened. But do you know I was laid up for some days after from the reaction?
To get back to Verdi, can you talk a little about Trovatore?
I auditioned with the two main arias there. Oh, by the way, when Gatti Casazza heard the cabaletta of the first act, he then said, who knows, one day I may have a Norma. Because it was dramatic coloratura. It wasn't a light coloratura. It was dramatic coloratura, full of gaiety and all. I let the voice pour. And he heard this agility in that aria, which gave him the idea that who knows, one day I may have one to succeed Lily Lehmann as Norma, because Lily Lehmann was the last one to do Norma before I did it 9 years later. I did it in 20. See, I debuted in 18, so 9 years later I was ready for the Norma.
Well, one of the great revivals for you in New York was Hernani.
Oh, yes, yes. Well, now, that was easy for me. Isn't that strange? Passages, for instance, that other artists found difficult, I found the easiest, like the trill in the Hernani of the first act. You know how long I hold that F. The instruments, by the way, the musicians would put their instruments down. The conductor would fold his arms with the baton and wait, see how long-winded I was going to be in that trill. And then on the upbeat, then up came the baton. And they'd all wait for that trill and the staccato that I do in the end couplet of the Hernani. And they'd wait for that, and they said, now we can go home. She's in good form. So that's the story of my life. Well, that is my debut. And my first records with Columbia, and there were many of them. I hope you enjoy them. The only thing I wish we had in all my recording days is more time so that I could have sung these arias or duets, whatever the word, as I would on the stage. Like they do today, you can take your time. There's no time element to speed, to hurry you up. But we had to watch that watch, and on the 3-minute limit, we had to speed up the tempo. It was very nerve-wracking to make recordings under those conditions.
Can you talk a little bit about recording into that horn?
Oh, that horn, yes. That used to frighten us so, because we, as we say, everything had to be flawless. Now, you spoke of the Otello, Ave Maria. The Ave Maria, which is all strings, begins with unmuted strings. And then when she's finished, she gets through. And then you have to stand there and hope that nothing will happen to those strings, because they play this beautiful, beautiful melodic bar after bar till the very last string with the muted tones. And we all held our breath, you know, because of one of those strings, especially when it's muted and we go way up out of that high register on the violin. It's very ticklish. It's like the French horn. You never know when they're going to crack, you know. But it was a very suspenseful ordeal for me for the 3-minute limit, because now La Casta Diva I did it twice as slow and 2 verses, and the second verse is entirely different than the first. By the way, I think I did the Norma with Columbia too, and then later was so much more mature, but a time element was there. I should have been born a little later, or they should have had these LPs a little sooner. Yes,